sing instead. Okay. All right, we're good. Well, thank you. So, same rules apply today as it did last week, or last session. Nicholas has graciously offered to allow me to draft the exam questions for this section. They will be on the conversation we have and not on the slides, all 41 of them. Intellectual property is a messy, messy topic. It's complex, nuanced, counterintuitive, and run by the government. It's something that I took some time attempting to persuade various executives in some large organizations as to why they should care about. And I started in the patent space, which was really the engine for driving economic returns in the industrial technology sector, oil and gas. And I found now that since I've moved to Kelowna and I'm working in the digital tech sector a lot, that copyright is the intellectual property piece that most engineers and developers and CEOs of startups run into challenges with. They're two very different forms of intellectual property. The rules are different, the stakes are different. And certainly when it comes to the digital tech sector here, the Copyright Act was not crafted in any way, shape, or form to respond to creativity in coding or other business applications. These acts go back to the turn of the century when the Industrial Revolution was taking place and things were a lot simpler, both in terms of the creative arts, copyright, and steam engines for patents. So we've got 41 slides here and there's a mountain of material to go through. You can, you know, read the acts yourself, you can find out about all the nuanced pieces, but there's probably five or six core concepts that I want to make sure that you leave this session with. It might be helpful for us to start with an example. Something we see on the road every day. I profess no bias towards any manufacturer or type of car. But, you know, if we look at this vehicle, it does give some illustration of the different types of intellectual property involved in a product. So we can see that Ford has, as part of their branding program, they've got the horse, which is trademark. So what does the trademark do? It's supposed to be a mark, a logo, a word, sound. I think we're even moving to a color at some point that associates in the consumer's mind the source of origin for the good. So it differentiates products, services from others by virtue of this brand, if you will. Trademarks are supposed to be something distinctive. And distinctive is different than descriptive. I get lots and lots of people starting companies up, and for whatever reason, rather than worrying about their business model and their product, they're always interested in their corporate name, and they're always interested in the brand and their trademark. We spend far too much time talking about that and the complexities of pursuing trademark applications and registering your rights not only in Canada but US and around the world. It's a very expensive proposition, but it's very valuable. And just like the mark itself, when you're looking at a trade name or a word mark, it needs to be distinct. So if you want to talk about being a financial corporation, you need to have something distinctive. Of course, there's limits to how distinctive you can be. Words that describe sexual acts are not particularly well received by the trademark office or other such things. So there is some morality. That's sort of the notion of trademarks. We see on the bottom left-hand side, we see some drawings. And this this is something that every engineer, regardless of the discipline that you're in, will come across. It is reducing an idea to something in tangible form. Whether it's a technical specification, whether it's code, whether it's a plan, a section, a cut sheet. And that's copyright. Probably one of the easiest forms of intellectual property to manage and handle on a day-to-day basis, and probably one of the least understood. Also probably one of the hardest to protect. So there are other aspects here as well. If we take a look at the shape of the car, there are particular features on the car that do not enhance its aerodynamic performance or its gasoline or other performance, but are there simply for aesthetic purposes. In Canada, we call that an industrial design. In the States, you call that actually patent those. Here, we call it industrial design. Another example of an industrial design is the gas station covers that Petro-Canada has. For a number of years, they have those registered. And again, that's all about branding, all about differentiating yourself in the marketplace from your competitors and your peers. There's costs associated with all of these. There's ongoing management activities associated with them. And there's also value associated with them. And where there's value and cost, there's also risk. Because others are in the same space, or they want to get in the same space. If you're making money, rest assured you're going to be followers. So if you are thinking about all of the aspects that go into creating a business, creating a product, developing some commercial benefit from the solution that you find to the technical problem that you've been asked to address, or the commercial problem that you've been asked to address, you can blow your brains out in terms of spending money on IP and time on other people. If you go to a patent agent, tell them you need a patent, they'll give you a patent. They won't think about how it supports your business. They'll just give you a patent. If you go to a trademark agent and ask for a trademark, they'll give you a trademark. They're happy to take your money. And it's not cheap. But what you really should be thinking about, your very first consideration is, what is your business strategy? Because your intellectual property strategy has one objective, and that's to support your business strategy. It may be that your business strategy, core to that is your intellectual property. It may be some particular solution that's driving the entire product development, or multiple product developments, or other. But if you remember that your intellectual property strategy drives your business strategy, you won't get lost talking to various agents and advisors on how much money you should spend and all of the risks that you need to take care of with respect to intellectual property. I don't sell patents. What I do sell is intellectual property strategic advice. So I spend a lot of time talking to startup companies, even mature companies, about their intellectual property. I've had many conversations where people have come in and proudly shown me their patent portfolios. And while they're not doing business in Korea may be a fancy or fantasy for their business trajectory, they're proud to show me their patents and degree. First thing I tell them to do is abandon. Doesn't matter how much money you've spent on them to date, there are ongoing costs for all of these pieces of intellectual property. They're government-run, and the government wants a piece of money to ensure that you keep it registered. Between your business strategy and your intellectual property strategy are other activities and other thoughts that you should be alive to in trying to create or position your business so that it differentiates itself, is competitive, and can generate the benefits that you want it to. So I also talk about supply chain strategy. It's another way of creating barriers to entry in the market. It's another way to create exclusivity. It's another way to create a competitive price point. And in addition to your supply chain strategy, you have a contracting strategy. again, that's something that can set you apart, align your interests with your supply chain, align your interests with your customer base, and do things that generate revenue and change your margin profile compared to others, even your risk profile. And somewhere in all of this, there's also an opportunity to differentiate yourself in your technical approach. That's one of the things I want you to leave this session with today, is that intellectual property is one aspect of a business that supports your business strategy. The backdrop for intellectual property, because it's government-run, you should have picked up right away that there are policies underlying the reasons these particular types of assets are recognized by government. And that's what they are. They are assets. We could spend a lot of time talking about movements and trends to monetize those and have them reflected in balance sheets of large corporations. But I can tell you, certainly in the tech space, the intellectual property is in many, many instances the only asset that the company has. They don't have a product line yet because they can't raise $100 million. But what they do is have a great idea, a great business plan, protected it, and they want to do one or two things. They want to raise some funds. So if I'm going to invest in something, I look at the intellectual property as core to my investment decision. There are other aspects of the corporation that will drive my decision as to whether I invest or not. The co-founding team is one of them. Their idea of how it fits in the marketplace, whether it has legs or others. But intellectual property is one. You can actually raise funds from banks on patents. So these are assets, these are creations of the mind that are recognized at law. They're typically recognized by virtue of statute. Statutes are subject to decisions by courts, so there's quite a bit of common law around it. And if the government is creating something or recognizing it by virtue of statute, there's a trade-off. So patents, the notion there is that in order to promote the dissemination of knowledge, because disseminating knowledge is a good thing, you can build on it and you can create from it, the government grants, in exchange for you providing a disclosure in your patent that will teach the public all about your knowledge, your technology, your solution, in exchange the government grants you exclusivity for that. You are the only one in the country that can make, use, or sell that product. Those are sort of the buzzwords. Make it, use it, or sell it. It's up to you to enforce it, which is a whole other conversation. Not only do you have to sink a bunch of money into capturing it, filing it, pursuing it, you also have to keep your eyes out in the marketplace for others that may be treading on your rights, and you're responsible for enforcing those, which is a whole other cost and expense. But the hammer that you get in enforcement is a big one. So patents are a high-stakes game. Big money at stake to get into the game, big money if you lose. So here's a bit of a summary. And we can talk about all of the elements for all of them and how long you get those rights for. And these things change over time. They're subject to judicial review. You may know that we're about to sign a number of foreign treaties to help the global economy move towards some level of consistency as to how these things are registered. And so, even our trademark term is going to change in about a year. It's going to go from a 15-year term to a 10-year term. Renewable if you pay your fee. So when I talk about it being a high-stakes game, there's lots of big organizations like General Electric, Yahoo, Apple, Samsung, NTP, and Zoom that have been in the game for a long time, spent a lot of money on it, and That's the game when you're in the product world, right? A competitive product. So what you don't do is look to commoditize your product, because that's a race to the bottom. You look to capture it, differentiate it. Patents is one way to do it. This is a dated slide. We all saw the billion-dollar judgment that came out between Apple and Samsung a while ago over patents and technical solutions that, frankly, were aesthetic. They were core to the iPhone. They were around the way you touch it and move through various screens. The energy sector is where I grew up and spent a lot of time strategizing for some of the companies there, looking at R&D spend, looking at the number of patents and what those patents are, what they mean, how you can generate and protect revenue streams around them. There's a number of different strategies you can adopt around patents. The first strategy . So to get a patent, you should really appreciate that there's a continuum through which you should look at the value the patent has and the enforceability of the patent. Patent does not mean that it's unassailable. It just means that it went through a government process, it's been issued, it's been granted, you paid your money, and it's presumed to be valid. In Canada, the Intellectual Property Office is the regulatory agency charged with vetting patent and trademark registrations and issuing them. When they're issued, they're presumed valid. But it's a court that actually decides, after a lengthy and time-consuming and costly process, as to whether the government did its job properly in the first place and what they issued should stand. So you should pick up right from that point that you've got something that's presumed valid. There's a way of assessing its strength and whether there's anything you can do strategically around that from a business perspective. So here's an interesting example. I don't have the case site here, but a couple of years ago, there was a small oil field services company in Calgary that did some stuff downhole. Apparently there was another company that suggested that what they were doing infringed on some patent rights they had. And the hammer that you have with patent rights is you have the right to shut somebody down that's infringing. So not only do you stop them from doing whatever it is they're doing, but if they have a product, you get them to deliver up that product to you. So you stop what they're doing, they hand over all of their product, all of their inventory, and then they pay you a bunch of money, lost profits, plus they pay your legal fees, and then they pay their own lawyers. This was a particular bet the company proposition that particularly hurt Pason Systems. And it's really interesting, if you look at that judgment, it goes on far too long. But if you count at the end of it the number of lawyers that were involved in that suit, and imagine what the legal fees were, and imagine what the outcome was, it wasn't pretty. There was a case that just came out last year between Nova and Dow Chemical, a similar thing. That was a $300 million judgment. Lots of lawyers' fees. So I'm trying to give you the impression here that things are complex. You don't have a lot of certainty around what you have at the end of the day, because a court has to decide that. And to make things even more uncertain, in Canada and the US, when you file your patent applications with the Patent and Trademark Office, they're held in confidence for 18 months. So you have this 18-month blind spot, and you're trying to make decisions on your R&D programs and how much money you're putting into your product development, and something could pop out of that pipeline and cause quite a surprise. Yeah, so the Patent and Trademark Office keep it confidential so the public cannot see your pending patent application. So you're in the midst of designing, developing, building, fabricating, spending money, hiring people and planning your business, and there's 18 months of applications in the patent office that you can't see, and you don't know whether they are in your space or in somebody else's space. And there's nothing you can do about it. Yes? A lot of those companies are offshore, right? And subject to, you know, Canada doesn't particularly view its authority as going beyond the borders. So if you look at what the states have done recently is that they've made some changes to their patent act so that they can enforce their patent rights on an extraterritorial basis. So they can go into Saudi Arabia and say, don't have a patent file there, but we're doing something that infringes on our laws, so we're going to slap some penalties on it. Yeah, I think I don't think that there's really an answer to your question other than where there's money, people are going to fall. Do I think it's fair? What the voters think, because they elect Congress who passed the laws, right? The other country doesn't have to, because the U.S. goes after the company. Or the infringer. Your question is, if there's a company in another jurisdiction that the U.S. decides has run afoul of its laws, what can the U.S. do about it? And so there's sort of two answers to that. One is, if they have assets in the U.S., they seize the assets and they execute on them. And if they don't have assets in the U.S., is there a reciprocal enforcement of judgments act between the two countries, as there is between Canada and the U.S., right? So if I'm suing somebody in the States, and they don't have assets in Canada, it doesn't really bother me. I get my judgment here in Canada, I go down to the U.S. court, and they recognize it, and I can execute on it down there. Yeah. But you're right, you need to make sure when you're contracting with different parties that the remedies you set up are something that you can actually realize. It may mean that your paper isn't good for much. Yes? See, that's a great question, because patents are granted by governments, so they're territorial in nature. And, you know, just to wax poetic here for a moment, in my former life, I used to get a lot of companies from the U.S. coming up and saying, we've got a great solution for the oil sands. We can do this for you, we can do that for you, look at our patent. And the first thing I would do is take a look at the patent, see that it was filed in the U.S., so it's enforceable in the U.S., that's where the rights are. And then I would check the Canadian Patent Office, and there's a time period between when it's filed in the U.S. and when it needs to be filed in Canada. And if there wasn't anything filed in Canada, and that time period had run out, they immediately went from becoming a supplier to a consultant. Because I could practice their solution without fear of any legal entanglement. They just dedicated that to the public. So, you know, that's a great question. And particularly since our markets are practically integrated, a very frequent filing strategy is to file in the U.S. because it does two things. They prosecute your applications quicker than in Canada, and you get a preview of how the Canadian examination process may roll out. Frequently, the Canadian process simply looks at what happens in the U.S. and does a rubber stamp. We also have a patent prosecution highway between the two countries so that if you get it in one, you can just jam it into the next country without any examination. So, lots of things to think about here. Way too procedurally complex. Paul, So you have exclusive rights in Canada, so you can actually, there are some laws that allow you to stop those shipments at the border or tip off customs so that they can hold them. And they're not particularly well drafted because there's a bunch of costs and risks that you incur. But you can actually have them seized right there and taken care of. Perhaps before we get into the next discussion thread, it seems I'm doing a lot of talking because this is just such a messy topic. I spent a lot of my career talking to inventors, most of them engineers, and without exception, all of them in explaining their technical solution to me have said that it's just their job. So if you talk to a patent agent about the criteria for eligibility for a patent, you're gonna get a long-winded story about a three-element test, and there's this and there's that. So you gotta watch this and you gotta watch that. My position has always been, if you arrive at a solution that has commercial benefit for your employer, we can do something to create additional value from it. So that's sort of the piece I want to talk about. But as problem solvers, what is obvious to you, what is just your job, is a much higher standard than what the patent office applies in determining whether a solution is patentable. Suspend your disbelief. Once you graduate and after you've been out for a while, you will then have been operating at a much higher standard of practice than what the patent office does. One of the stories I have is when I first started at Synovus, one of my classmates had done a significant amount of the design work up in Christina Lake's facilities, and told me as we were going up that there was nothing unusual there, nothing patentable. It was just their work. And I listened for two things. I listened for him saying, we do this better than anyone else, and this is the way we do it. I came up with a list of 7 or 8 ideas and was able to patent all of them. So suspend your disbelief is the message there. I thought it might be, frankly, easier for me to not have to talk and just to offer up a problem on the board and think about how many issues come from that. So what I'd like to do is read it all together, and then we can identify the issues and how we would address the issues from that. So here's an example that comes up all the time. You're an engineer. You're trying to improve the operation of your business by finding some technical enhancement, advantage, modification. And sometimes, you know, ideas and solutions come together when there's more than one mind at play. So people that operate things compared to people that design them and build them generally have very different perspectives and can learn a lot from each other. In this particular example, there's company that has a facility that operates a pump. The pump is in a special service. Let's say it's multi-phase. And for whatever reason, they need to enhance the performance of it. So they get a pump designer involved. They come up with a new solution, come up with a new pump. The company is paying the designer to come up with the pump. And yet, the pump company has gone and filed the patent out. The agreement, oddly enough, is silent on IP, even if there is an agreement. Somebody probably got paid, somebody probably said yes, and that's about all there is. So how many issues are there? see this board, but it's the closest I can do to. So I guess the first question is what does company XYZ want to do with this? The obvious question is, do they just want to buy the pump? Another question might be, are they interested in getting into the pump manufacturing and retail business? Do they want to sell them? So that's, what did I put that one as? Yeah, does, by virtue of Pumpco having a patent, does that put them at a commercial disadvantage? So that's the strategic thinking, absolutely. And then I think the other question has a couple of parts, which is, does Pumpco have the right to file for the patent application? And does it own the IP rights to the pump? This is an issue that happens all the time. So the question is, you know, if we just take them one at a time, if they just want to buy the pump, do they need a license? I think the answer is pretty obvious there. Think about your cell phone that you've got. Anyone's got an iPhone, you know there's half a dozen patents on that. Did you need to buy a license to get the product? No. So why is that? Yes. That part of the patent scheme?
Well, if you were to buy an iPhone, tear it down, reverse engineer it, you have no product licenses for the patent.
So are the two mutually exclusive? Is ownership in a piece of property exclusive from the rights the patent holder has to make, use, or sell, including use? Make, use, or sell. And I don't expect anyone to know the answer to this. In fact, most practitioners don't even know it, but there's something called the doctrine of patent exhaustion. And it identifies a tension between property ownership and intellectual property rights. The hard lesson some companies have failed to learn, or learned the hard way, is that you need to ensure your agreement transfers not just title to you, but sufficient ability to use your product without having to implicate patent rights. So it does happen where products are sold, title is transferred, but there's restrictions on use rights that as you may own the title to it, but you can't use it in some of the ways that would benefit your organization without running afoul of the patent holder's rights to that product. Yeah, how does that make sense? To look something up for you on that one. So, you know, are they looking to make and sell the pump? I think the answer there is pretty clear. Since they don't have the patent rights, they would have to obtain a license to do that. So the next one, does allowing the pump manufacturer to have the patent rights create some sort of commercial disadvantage for the company? And the obvious answer to that is yes, because you're tied to one manufacturer who can charge whatever price they want. In fact, one of the beauties of patents is if it's, you know, if you're a supplier, of course you want to sell it. But if you're an owner, so these guys own the patent, they operate the facility, then they don't have to sell it. So if you go and ask Shell about some of their technologies, they don't license them. You have to spend a whole bunch of time and money to create your own solution, which will likely take you longer to get into that particular market and put you at a disadvantage because you've lost that market lead, incurred additional costs, and your solution is probably less effective. So here's something interesting. Does PumpCo have the right to file that patent? After all, the company paid for it. Does patent equal ownership? Yes. Yeah, it's the supplier. It's pretty quiet. I'm ready to go to sleep too. So, does payment equal ownership of the intellectual property rights associated with the pump? So from last class, what you heard was, take a look at the contract. Right, take a look at it. It's silent. You just got yourself a dispute. So how does title or ownership to intellectual property in this context flow? What does that look like? So we know that intellectual property is not the creation of companies. Companies act through individuals. The individuals in this instance are called inventors. So the inventors are the ones that created that technology, that solution. And an inventor is identified through the application of a legal test. Lots of times you see managers and supervisors and brothers and sisters and mothers getting named as inventors. They are not inventors. That's not a problem, generally. If you have someone that did not contribute, that is named as an inventor on your patent, it's an annoyance, but there's no real legal risk associated with it. On the other hand, if you have someone that's an inventor that is not named on the patent, that has not transferred their intellectual property rights, and the mechanism of transfer is called an assignment, has not assigned their rights to the corporation through a document called an assignment, that's a fatal flaw. All of the time and effort and money that you've spent preparing and filing that patent application will be attacked and it will fall because you didn't capture all of the inventors. So the question then becomes, and this happens all the time as well, if our friends at PumpCo filed a patent application, did they correctly identify, name, and obtain patent assignments from all of the inventors? And did they even do that with inventors from XYZ? That's how I caught one situation like this, is when an employee came to me and said, I just got this assignment, they want me to sign it. Then I found out there was a technical solution. I found out that there was a patent application that was prepared and ready to file. And that's when the real negotiation starts. So from a simple example like that, that occurs quite frequently, there's a lot of issues. I see this all the time in the digital tech sector here, where there's developers that are coding and they're getting together and preparing algorithms and this and that, and it's all coming together, and there's no agreement on ownership, there's no agreement on assignment. And while you may talk about trust and understanding, these acts are so prescriptive that you can only assign copyright, for example, by way of a written document that is signed. So goodwill, emails, not good enough. Well, the energy in the room is keeping me barely awake. Why don't we take a break?
Basically, have to write the this report. We don't do any practical reading.
No?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah, I got that for last
week. Yeah, we do.
For C. E was great.
You have the project already?
Yes, it's number 10.
Oh, did you just get it?
No, like a week ago, or maybe 2 weeks. We just have like meeting tomorrow, so I have to start getting ready.
Wait, do we have a meeting tomorrow?
No.
No. So
we will have a meeting tomorrow.
No.
got the pleasure of each other's company for another 20 or 25 minutes. We can spend it any way we want. Got probably another 30 slides to go through. So just to perhaps put a point on the problem we looked at. So some of you may or may not have heard about the Park Plus fiasco in Calgary, which was the parking system the city developed, and it was one of the first where you put the license plate number in, and then they have a car that's got a whole bunch of different cameras on it, and it just drives through the parking areas and identifies those plates that had expired or had not paid for their parking. And the city of Calgary had quite a bit of interest from other cities looking to license that technology. In the midst of one of those licensing exercises, someone decided to do some due diligence and asked for evidence that the rights had been properly assigned to the city to the patents so that they could go out and license it. And if you follow the torrid tale, there's a couple of learnings here, and one that I've seen many, many places. The first is that the City of Calgary didn't have an employment agreement or an employee agreement for intellectual property. The very first document I signed when I started my career as an engineer was an assignment of IP rights when I went to work for the engineering company that's now called Jacobs. The City of Calgary didn't have that. So does that mean that as an employee, anything you create or develop or solutions you arrive at indoors and not the companies? No. What it means is that the common law, as opposed to a written contract, applies. And as we talked last Tuesday, there's these eight factors that have to be considered and reviewed, and the court decides as to whether it was something the employee should own or the company. Which means a lawsuit, which is what happened here in the City of Calgary. So they didn't have that, they didn't get the assignments, and it appears that two of the major players or contributors to that technology decided they didn't want to assign it. So this went on for a number of years, lots of legal fees. I think Bennett Jones made a bunch of money on it. And at the end of the day, the two people that were contributors and valued, they ended up getting terminated. Lots of bad things happened. It's a cautionary tale and not an unusual one. And it happens to big companies as well. So something to think about. Was all over the news, as it should be.
Can you summarize very briefly why this one?
It's typically financial, and these poor sods didn't realize that when they went up against the city how deep they would have to dig into their own pockets to defend. They got blackballed probably, so who else is going to hire them? And fundamentally, it was a solution they created in the course and scope of employment, during employment time, using employment materials, they got paid for, all of the factors were there. And they just thought they could put a gun to the city's head, and I think the city, said, got a gun to ours, but doesn't have any bullets in it. We've got the bullets. Yeah, so those are easy cases. And who wins? The lawyers win in those cases. You may imagine that intellectual property and particularly products, patent products, lend themselves to some pretty interesting strategic considerations. And there's a variety of strategies you can adopt in pursuing a patent strategy for a product line. You can be offensive, and so the purpose there is to protect your revenue stream. You can be defensive, and all you care about there is your freedom to operate. You're not going to get entangled with anyone else. Does anyone have a sense as to a typical dollar value for a patent? So if you're planning on going down the patenting process, what's a typical you know, if you're making a business case for filing a patent, it's a typical dollar value you would associate with that. $10,000 to $12,000. So does that include your time? Does that include the inventor's time? Does that include the corporate time? Does that include the maintenance fees that are ongoing? Does that include responding to the examiner's requests and questions? Or is that just the fee for the patent agent to do the initial draft? One of the answers was $10,000 to $12,000. I think if you deal with sophisticated parties, they typically associate a life cycle cost, rule of thumb, $250,000. So when I was putting my budget together and planning and filing patents for my various clients, I had to be able to stand up to the executive committee and explain to them what the purpose, the value, and the strategic intent behind. Quite a commitment, particularly if you're working in a technology group and you have to enforce, whether it's enforce or defend. You then take the brains that have created these solutions for you and you commit them to a year or more of sitting in a dark basement going through examinations for discovery. So you're taking the brains that are making your money defend it now and take them away from revenue generation. That's a really big hit for a company. Yes? So the question is, you've got solutions or innovations that qualify for more than one patent, and rather than spending money on patents for all of them, can you bundle them? And so there's a concept at patent law called unity of invention. And you're allowed one patent per invention. So you have to file them separately. But there's always exceptions, right? So for strategic purposes, you may bundle them and rely on the patent office to force you to divide your patent into two, three, or four. And there are strategic benefits to that. So not only is your filing strategy where you file, how you file, what you're filing on, there's a lot of thought that should be going into this, all focused on what your business strategy is. But if you go to a patent agent with those five, they're going to give you five patents, they're going to charge you for five patents, and you're not going to know whether they're good, bad, or indifferent. How do you gauge the quality of your patent? Most consumers of patents are unsophisticated. This slide was simply intended to identify that intellectual property is at pretty much throughout your organization. It touches on your human resources, like your employment agreements. It touches on business development. If you're selling something, you better have the rights to it. It touches on industry consortia, so if you're coming together with industry partners and you're all contributing to a solution, who's going to own it? What does ownership look like? Who's going to pay for it? Who's going to make the decisions during crafting it? If I've got my patent portfolio, they have their patent portfolio, and we come up with a solution that somehow benefits both, how do I make sure that the claims are drafted in a way that benefit my portfolio more than theirs? Because we know there's going to be overlap. Scientific research and experimental development is a Canadian federal program that a lot of startups live on. There's a couple of different tiers to it, but it's good money if you're a startup and you qualify. And if you, you're in an engineering field, like you qualify. Lots of good people in town here who can help you with that for free. And you should be able to do that yourself. Talk about enforcement. Governance, freedom to operate. It really transcends all aspects of your organization. Nope, not done yet. Let me see if we can do another question here.
types of questions. Don't have the problem though. Anybody could help me. I wanted to go back. Okay, so here's an example that I'm frequently involved in as well. You've got a company with some cash. They have a focus on a target who has some intellectual property, some technology, and they want to acquire the company. So let's all read this together. You obviously do some due diligence before you buy anything, right? Whether it's a test drive of a car, some reports. Organization, there's a number of aspects to your due diligence. If it's a technology, you look at the agreement, you perform a technical review to make sure the science is sound. You should be looking at the evidence of their intellectual property. And in this particular instance, they looked at a whole bunch of patents. That's core to the acquisition, core to the value of the acquisition. And it turns out after the closing of the transaction, so the company was acquired, one of the inventors went and assigned his rights to a competitor company. Wow, how often is that? So what do you do if you're the one that bought the company and there's a core patent, and one of the inventors on that patent went and assigned their rights to your competitor? What do you do with that? So why don't we start by identifying the issues? One of the issues probably being, how much longer do I have to sit here and listen to this? Countdown. Yeah, please. Thank you. You can get on full time if you keep helping me like that. No. So you can put that up. So the first question is, if I'm doing my due diligence, so I've got a patent. Did all of the inventors assign their rights to the company? If they did, I want to know what type of an assignment it was. And if they didn't, well, that's a whole other conversation, probably. Is a short one, and there's no check exchange at the end of it. And then at the end of this mess, what are the remedies? So if I've got this company and I've got this patent, there's some challenges. What are the remedies? So why don't we just look to the next slide? So what you look for in an assignment is that it is irrevocable. Who would have thought that I can sign a right and yet retain the right to claw that right back? For all, it was my right, wasn't it? Shouldn't I be able to, just like consent, I can provide consent and I can withdraw consent. So I want to make sure it's an irrevocable one. Company A who buys Company B. Company B had a patent that you wanted. The patent had inventor 1 and inventor 2. And after you bought it, inventor 2 went and assigned their rights to that patent to Company C. Easy, eh? Easy. So, was it an irrevocable assignment? If it is, great, no problem, right? What if it's revocable? What happens then? Well, if it's revocable, you may find yourself in a place where all of a sudden you're what's called a joint owner. Two parties on title. And you may think, well, that's not bad. I've got my undivided 50% interest or whatever the heck interest it is. I can do whatever I want with it. And that's the mistake a lot of Canadians make. So there's a BC case called Forget versus Specialty Tools. I just named it there. So the rule in Canada is very different than the rule in the US. This happens in the US. Yeah, you're annoyed, but it really doesn't affect your ability to use or exploit. In Canada, there's restrictions. All of a sudden, it's sort of like your assignment's twin. You want to go this way, they want to go that way. You've got to agree on which way you're going to go. It's not quite that bad, but it's sufficiently concerning that you want to make sure you know when you go into these endeavors what the outcome's going to be. Well, that might be a good exam question, eh? Joint ownership, tell me the pros and cons on that. So what happens if they didn't have the assignment from Inventor 2? Well, as we've said, it's okay to have more purported inventors as long as you've got the right ones, and it's a fatal flaw if you don't have the right one, because that will be found and you will not be happy. So what are the remedies? So if just for the sake of argument, if I bought this and found out that they did not have the assignment, what's my remedy? So presumably there's a purchase and sale agreement between A and B, and if you had a good lawyer that knew IP, yes?
Can you get your money back? Because you paid for something that you didn't buy?
Buyer beware? Yeah, so I think you're right on track with that notion, though. You make sure that your purchase and sale agreement has certain promises in it, certain representations and warranties, and there's a specific one related to this issue. And in the event that they breach that, they breach the contract, and you get your remedies that way. Typically, in these sorts of agreements, you actually define what those damages would be rather than have to lead a whole bunch of evidence and go to court. You put aside a pool of money in the millions, and in the event that there's a breach, you just claw that back. Not a pleasant place to be in. But hey, lawyers' bills get paid. I guarantee you that. So, I have a couple of other slides I'd like to go through. This should only take a couple of hours. So there's a couple of misconceptions around patents that I just wanted to chat about. So we've already talked about this one a bit. An operator in the field comes up with a method for improving pump performance. You'd think that I like pumps, I don't know why. Which results in the 20% cost savings. This is just good engineering practice, right? I'm just optimizing my design, I'm just refining, clarifying, improving, enhancing, modifying, advancing. The standard that the patent office applies in determining whether a solution is innovative is a person of ordinary skill in the art. Once you graduate and have a bit of experience under your belt, you will no longer be a person of ordinary skill in the art. You will be operating at a much higher standard than that. typical, the typical standard I apply is a fresh engineering graduate is a person of ordinary skill in the area. No seasoning. Add seasoning, they're beyond that. Here's another one. Anyone working on a technology for which a patent application is filed is an inventor. Well, how many times do we have to beat that horse? And even if you're the one running the experiments, setting up the different numerical simulations, putting data sets together, analyzing results, that's technical, that's tactical, that's not innovative. Having a patented technology means I can practice it. So we've talked about the 18-month blind spot, and because patents are government work, and just by virtue of their nature, there are overlaps. It's not uncommon to have claims overlapping amongst patents. Co-owners of a patent are free to exploit their application. Well, we've talked about that too. And we've also talked about the last one, which is I pay, so I own. I think I'm right on time. So, thank you. Any questions? I'll be sticking around. This is a, yes. So the question was, I'm an employee in a company, I'm working for the company, I invent something. What is the percentage ownership between the inventor and the company? So what does the contract say? Yeah, this is a messy topic.
Evgeny, did you talk to Tanner?
No, that was not a chance.
What?
You're an inventor, you're an engineer, and you come up with a really good idea, and you want to actually develop it into a fully patentable idea.
It's good.
Should you start by doing a patent search first?
Wasn't bad. How's it for you? Tricky?
Probably give you a different answer than the one you were expecting.
Could you study?
Solid understanding of the landscape.
Just the population, pretty much the population goal.
Solutions that have been tried for that problem by others.
First order. I don't think you could agree.
Whether you use Google patents, literature, or whether you look at scientific literature,
and
part of your innovation process.
The one where you guessed the cue.
It should
this one was the guess
the
cue.
Way you approach that problem. So. Now that's not the way it plays out.
There's only really four or five.
Nobody bothers to do that until their solution is done and they bring it to me and they say, I'm ready to patent it. And you will look and say, yeah, your baby's not very good looking. Somebody else had one before. Yes.